Song in a while.
No, I
haven't heard my own voice in a while.
I heard it. I heard it last weekend. Albeit in a different tempo, I guess.
Yeah, is it fast? I'm sure it's faster.
Flat Out Fever F1 podcast.
We have returned. We're back again.
So you know how we keep saying that we're gonna make this thing way more regular and like better. Like over the past like 10 podcasts or so.
It's tough, guys.
Yeah. Life really hard.
Finds a way.
Finds a way. Jurassic Park.
Yes.
Life does find a way. That was a reference.
Speaking of, there was this picture of Arrivabene here. photoshopped on top of three velociraptors.
It's also the fifth member of the Beatles.
It's really taken off. Like, but look. So you guys know the context behind it, right?
He was in a pit lane or something like that.
Well, okay. Well, he's new to F1, right?
And like, oh, is he really?
Well, he's new to being an F1. Like, he's not new to F1, of course. Right. I'm sorry, I said something stupid that I shouldn't have said. No, Arrivabene is not new to F1. He's been associated with the Ferrari F1 team since the fucking Senna days. He's been around for a while, but he's new to being a team principal. And being a team principal, like, and actually,
is that like a coach?
Well, yeah, he's the guy that's ultimately in charge. And actually, Ted Kravitz, in his many segments over the Austrian Grand Prix weekend on Sky, he made a pretty cool segment of like, he's just basically like, saying what is it like to be a team principal, and he made a couple of very good points. One of them is definitely that it's not like being a coach in a sport like international soccer or hockey, mm-hmm. in the sense that like you can, you know, those guys in the international soccer or hockey, like you're wearing a suit if you're like the main guy, and and you can yell at your players, and you can be a
what the fuck were you thinking?
Yeah, you can be a controversial figure, but no,
all of them say that.
a team principal in F1, you have to assume that role,
right?
But on top of that, you're also the spokesperson for your team, and with your team come your sponsor. So you have to like,
gotta be a good boy.
Yeah. So yeah, during the week. Yeah. And if anything goes wrong,
if you get smushed in the pit lane.
No, but yeah, if a pit lane goes bad, like it ultimately relies on you. If a pit stop goes wrong, if anything is happening with, like, if you're not getting enough sponsorship, what's happening with McLaren? If they're not getting like enough sponsorship, then it relies on you. Like you're the ultimate person that the media is going to come up to you, and it's a great amount of pressure, and definitely I'm sure there's a lot more than we could ever imagine going on in Arrivabene's head, but this was kind of a rookie mistake. He left the pit wall, and he was definitely just gonna like walk across the pit lane going to his garage, and like you could see him, he looked left as if he was just crossing a normal street,
right.
And then he forgot to look right, and Massa was coming at 100 kilometers an hour, which is the pit limitation.
Maybe not quite.
Yeah, but he was still like if that had been a less experienced driver, or if that had been a Marussia, like you know what I mean?
I think my favorite one is the Tiger.
Yeah, I got yelled at by a police officer this morning. I stepped it. Well, I wasn't about to get run over, but he made it out like I was.
Right.
You know what I mean?
He's worried about you.
He's like, hi. He was, serving and protecting.
Step back,
guess.
Please.
No. He said, he's like, fuck.
This is
man.
Awesome.
Oh, really?
I just looked at him like,
sorry.
No, but
I saw the bus.
This has exploded like all over Twitter. Like, I think it was actually started by the Lotus people.
Oh, really?
Go up. I think that this picture was this one here, like the Beatles, like Abbey Road one, was posted by the Lotus F1 team. And like Lotus F1, like they're known for like their social media team is like always like very like tongue in cheek and whatever.
Right.
So they posted this picture, and since then, like people have been photoshopping his picture of like him being scared at Massa coming. But he handled it really well. I saw the footage. I was watching.
Did he just give like a little thumbs up?
Yeah, exactly. He just like, sort of stepped away and was like, yeah.
I fucked up.
He's so cool. But anyway, apparently once all this exploded, he was interviewed by Italian media and you could say that maybe he wasn't too pleased about it.
Mm. What was he supposed to say? Like,
It does go back to what you're saying, and like since you pointed it out, and I guess I just hadn't noticed it, but since you pointed it out, I guess there is a huge amount of shit talking in F1. This is,
oh my god, it's fucking huge, man.
This is what keeps us entertained, like in the off time.
No, seriously.
Like,
yeah. How much shit can you fucking throw at each other?
But it's a very European take on sports, I guess.
Yeah, sure. Well, I guess soccer is. I don't know. Is there a lot of shit talking in soccer?
I guess not. I guess soccer is.
I've
like,
heard like
there's fighting.
Very
in
large
soccer.
Chance.
The just like fighting itself. This way, equate. F1 to MMA, so
this is where the wrestling
just another similarity.
It's
the shit talking,
and I'm sure it has something to do with the fact that association football, which is the technical name of soccer,
right.
like soccer is association football because you're playing with a team sports. Mm-hmm. Team sports in general, they have a different dynamic. Racing and fighting. As it's different.
It's more individual.
Yeah, it's
that's why I love the two sports.
You're the fastest, like, or you're the strongest.
The strongest, or the quickest. Yeah, guy or the best
like jiu-jitsu, like, or you know, I guess in the late 70s, early 80s, international chess play used to be a thing because it's you're the best at it. Like there's no contention. You win at it
until Deep Blue.
Yeah,
beat Garry Kasparov.
Yeah,
see in hockey people chirp the shit out of each other on the ice.
Yeah.
Like, they do that, but they're like, I'm not going to Twitter. I'm going to see this guy in fucking a week at their place, and I'm going to beat the shit out of him. I'm just going to come after him. It's just very fast. Like, you talk shit, you get this shit kicked out of you. And then you're like, you send like a passive-aggressive tweet, and you're like, oh,
and it's out
fuck.
There for the
and
world. Yeah.
Everyone's like, if you ever watch like where players are mic'd,
no.
Like ice hockey players are mic'd, and it's hilarious because they just talk so much shit to each other,
like in the heat of the moment.
Yeah. Oh, totally. That's hilarious.
Now they put mics in their helmets, have a radio button on the stick, and
talk to the coach. They can all talk to the coach.
Yo, man.
But no, the coach can yell at you from the bench. It's fine. Like you can hear them. Yeah. The fucking crowd can hear them. Stop! What are you fucking doing? You idiot.
Yeah.
Come on, refs. There's a video online where like a coach like threw a bench on the ice. It was a few years, like I think many, many years ago.
NHL?
Oh yeah, he was very upset. He was just like, ah, he just threw a bench on the ice. He was upset.
That is cool.
Yeah. Not really.
Well,
it's kind of embarrassing.
I guess we are supposed to at this point do our whole like
look back at Austria.
No. I already did the introduction of what this is, but I guess we have a Twitter account and we're on Reddit and flatoutfever.com, and if you like that tune at the beginning, go listen to bamboo.com. Oh yeah.
Yeah. For those
of you that are just listening or didn't know, Mike is in a very sweet Toronto band called Bamboo, which played, like, I cannot stress this enough, last weekend at the legendary Horseshoe Tavern. If you're Canadian, maybe, or if you're in the Toronto area, you would know this place. It's
bumping.
Well, it's a legendary Toronto venue, and you guys secured a show for North by Northeast, which is one of the it's one of the biggest music festivals in that happened in Toronto,
especially
the
like
year.
Indie, in that sort of sense.
Yeah, for bands your size.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, but that was a cool show. I'm actually legitimately sorry for you that you missed it, Danny, because it was.
I know.
I remember being on stage and seeing our friend Nick. in the crowd, and he was just fucking tired.
No, like, every at that point, everybody was tired. But like, we're just not used to it. It's not like over here. It's not like in Europe, the bars are open 24/7 or whatever. Like over here, bars close at 2 o'clock. But really, you're thinking of going home and make it home by 2. Like, yeah,
I gotta fucking kind of wake up and do shit tomorrow.
Yeah, I gotta get shit done, nigga. We're having economy here.
Like I don't want to fuck up my sleep schedule. Like.
No, but yeah, you got split at 2, and I am very glad that I was there. We gave you your first encore.
Yeah, you totally fucking did.
Yeah,
that was a very great experience. You and Megan. Megan was just like, yeah, Javier just started singing it, and Megan would follow along. And
oh, she actually was like, she tapped me, and she was like, one more song. And I was like, yes!
I can hear you above everyone else. You just have this cadence in your voice.
Oh, Jesus. I wish I knew what cadence was. No, it was fun as hell. And honestly, if you're listening to us from anywhere around the Toronto area, come to the next Bamboo Show, which is going to be when and where?
It's looking like August 13th somewhere.
Okay.
Lee's Palace.
We'll keep you updated. But yeah, most likely Lee's Palace, another legendary. Do you know that Lee's Palace was the first venue that Red Hot Chili Peppers played in Toronto?
In Canada,
yeah. Red Hot Chili Peppers and also the White Stripes.
Yep. There it is.
Yeah, there you go.
We follow in the footsteps of our leaders.
But going back to F1.
Let's do it.
That week, though, last week, we're sorry. I don't know if anybody's actually like yearning for a podcast more than like we are, but we couldn't make it. You were sick. Yeah. We had timing problems. It's been a rocky road, especially recently. I feel like
summer always does that, right?
Yeah,
it's just I want to go outside.
yeah. I've had like weddings to go to. Why is everybody getting married?
Weddings?
Yeah. What's going on with
elope people?
Yeah, exactly.
I love how it's like it's not just a wedding you're going to. It's like three other things. It's like the bachelor party, the Jack and Jill, another bachelor party, another Jack and Jill. You know what I mean?
Yeah, for sure.
Gifts for all these parties. You have to put thought into.
No, yeah. My gift is just my presence. I'm here. I made it. I got like friends in Peterborough. They're like, oh, you got to come to Peterborough. I'm like, oh, guys, it's like fucking driving so far. Yeah. I'm sorry.
But we are definitely trying to make it better. And actually, we've been toying with this idea of like maybe making the show live. Eventually, it'll happen. We'll figure it out, guys. Yeah. We'll get this up and running on a more regular basis. But for now, we're going to talk about the last Grand Prix that happened since the last time. Okay, so the last podcast that we did was the Canadian Grand Prix debrief, where we talked about many things except for the Canadian Grand Prix, because there wasn't, let's be honest, a lot to talk about the actual Grand Prix except for the fact that we were there.
Yeah. It was like so long ago.
Yeah, it was ages ago, eh?
What was that, 2-3 months ago?
At least. I don't know.
But now since then, Austria happened.
I know, yeah.
Austria! Österreich!
Yeah, it happened. Not the most exciting race ever.
Should we delve right into that?
I
thought that I had, and this may just be a reflection of the state of the sport as it is right now, but I took like in my fucking shitty little notebook, I took more notes out of practice than
out of the actual race
because for many reasons, but anyway, let me just like run you through.
This is the first weekend the whole year. I didn't see any practice.
Really?
And I didn't see the race till Tuesday.
Well, the practice was interesting, not because of anything really that happened in practice itself, but there were a couple of cool pointers. I mean, Ferrari looked fast. Eventually, they proved to not have been that competitive.
Vettel
got fourth.
He got
passed. Massa actually got third.
Yeah.
I think he's in one of my fucking things.
NASA.
Yeah.
I forgot to make my predictions. Man, like,
What I liked about watching practice is all the commentary, and I think I guess it's no secret that we watched the Sky broadcast when we can, because it is the best English language broadcast and probably the best broadcast out there. But Crofty and Ted Kravitz have just developed like this new dynamic that is hilarious.
Has it gotten worse?
Well, they clearly are in contempt of each other, but
yeah. Okay, I've noticed it for years now. It's been going on for years. There's always something. Croft is the worst.
Yeah. Crofty, like out of the two.
He's the antagonizer.
Yeah.
Of the two.
But
Ted just wants to chill out in his sandals. And that's it. That's all he wants to do.
The one thing that they were talking about, especially like Ted, by being there, and like one of the things that he did bring up during practice is that it's clear that the Red Bull, he described as the Red Bull magic, is gone. It's like you...
The fuck does that even mean?
Well, but it used to be, you know, they won four championships in a row. And
in a row.
Even before they were winning championships, they were like the fun team. Like you would right. go, you would go as a, if you had like a, if you had a pit pass or whatever, you could go at
take
any time.
Shots with them.
Well, yeah, well, you could go on and just hang out at Red Bull. And like everybody would be like very happy. And like, but
that's
apparently
all
that's
fucking coked up on Red Bull.
Exactly. No, but not, yeah, I guess Red Bull is not enough at Red Bull now. Like
at the Canadian done. Grand Prix though, at the track, yeah. You missed out, but who was doing backflips on motorcycles?
Monster people.
Yeah,
hey.
Wait, is that
where's our video, Mike?
Oh man, yeah. It's there.
Yeah, it's in the pipeline.
It's coming.
Can we say that before the next podcast we'll have that video up?
Absolutely.
Okay, absolute man. Okay.
Absolute man.
Yeah, happen. But there were no Red Bull dudes on motorcycles doing backflips at the Canadian Grand Prix. There was four guys in monster suits. Yeah.
I'm monster just gonna throw chance. I thought Monster was owned by Red Bull.
No, it ain't.
Who's it owned by?
It's some American.
I think the Coca-Cola Corporation.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh.
I believe. You wanna look it up? Find out?
I'm gonna do it right now.
Yeah. Do I do it right now?
I'm pretty sure it's Coca-Cola though.
No, but yeah, one thing that they did point out, and the way that Ted explained it is that
Monster F1.
Well, you would go into Red Bull, and like there would be a party atmosphere, and like even when they were not being the world champions, it would still be fun. It would still be great, and like the dynamic was great, and everybody was, you know, joking around, and it was like the fun thing to do is to go hang out at Red Bull. But now, definitely, all of that is gone. He described it akin to being at a funeral, like everybody's just sort of like with their heads down, walking around, like nobody
How
really wants
be that bad.
Nobody really wants to talk to you because of the whole thing, man. With Renault, right?
Ricciardo's smile can't even.
Oh, they're their own
anyone's day.
Company, Monster.
Oh yeah, okay.
Yeah. Yeah? Hansen's Natural Sodas.
as well as McLaren, and rightfully so, like Both cars retired. Obviously, okay, yeah, could say that. You could say that Alonso
didn't exactly retire.
Yeah, he was thinking about Kimi, and I want to put an idea out there. I want to say that
I think he might have taken out Kimi.
No. What happened? What apparently happened is that Kimi lost it. He definitely lost the car. He misjudged his throttle response. And the back wheels just spun too much and took out Alonso. Mm-hmm. Whether like, and there's two things that could have happened there, right? Like whether he misjudged his throttle response or misjudged Alonso being there. That's still amateur. That's an amateur hour. You shouldn't be doing that. And at that point, so remember what is one thing that I said at the last podcast that coming up or no, actually, no, when I talked to you at the show, we were talking like outside of the horseshoe. And I said, listen, if anything is going to be interesting because, this weekend, this weekend. It's going to be Kimi Raikkonen's opportunity to prove
himself. What,
yeah,
oh, right.
Yeah, prove himself. Because before that in Canada, Vettel, like, you know, he went up the field from a low position to up, and he demonstrated great racecraft. So I was like, I said to Mike, listen, this is going to be Kimi Raikkonen's time to prove himself as well, and to make sure that he's going to get a drive next year, and work his way up the pack. What did he do? He crashed. You can't tell me that it wasn't. And as much as I like Kimi Raikkonen, I do, and I remember his days driving for McLaren, and I know that he's on top of being like a very cool guy, he's a good driver in his days, but that was a rookie mistake, and we're gonna look back at the Austrian Grand Prix at the moment when he lost his F1 drive. I'm sure he's not gonna be in the grid next year.
Oh fuck!
Because of that,
and because of that, how much on a scale of 1 to 10 does Alonso just want to die?
Oh well,
like he's just kind of like, well, fuck.
Both Alonso and Button are
taking a lot of deep breaths.
You can't help but feeling bad for those guys. They're every time that the press comes out to them, it's like, oh, what am I gonna say now to make it sound like
no, we are less on bad right than it was. Right track. It's just tough.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah,
it's like,
yeah.
That's all you can say.
That's all they can say. Poor guys.
Like they're both like later in their careers.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
They have the experience and well,
the experience.
And,
yeah,
but
that's the word.
But the Honda CEO was there, and definitely like that was some sort of pressure, and him being there still like didn't do anything.
Yeah.
To make the
well, like he was like bringing some sort of like Japanese gods to magic.
Yeah, no,
some potions for the drivers.
Maybe that will help them do better in the next in the
future.
Well,
they just
need
to realize the state that they're in, and I'm sure they're well aware of that. But it's definitely not a good.
Well,
spot.
Now it's real. Like if it wasn't real before to upper management at Honda, now it's a for real thing, and they've clearly committed. So even if you were looking at it in a very pragmatic point of view,
right.
You've already signed the contract. So the worst thing that you can do is just let it slide into oblivion. I'm sure. I you know what? I'm not sure, but I really hope that this helps. To at least like get people on the right track, because, like it's not just me being an Alonso fan, right. or anything. Even if it was anybody else driving that car, Honda should be doing like the Honda engine shouldn't be doing that. Right. And by now, this is the point, right? This is the point when we expected them to be in the podium or at least challenging for a podium.
This is what I don't get. I've said this before. I'll say it again. I've had
I love being a turtle. What?
Seven or eight Hondas, right? And five of them were over a 500,000 kilometers on the odometers.
Holy fuck.
Yeah, I had two in the 600s, one in the fives, and two in the high fours or one in the high fours. Yeah, it's ridiculous. I had one. I had one Honda Civic with a blown head gasket. So like when you open the coolant reservoir and you pulled it open, it was like a spider web of oil inside there. Where the coolant and oil was just mixed. There was no exhaust pipe on the car. The exhaust header just went dumped straight under the hood. And it
worked.
Yeah, I drove it like
Thank
that.
You.
I drove it like that for about 2 months.
Yeah, because it's safe to do that.
It's safe to do that. That's not.
It's just not recommended.
It's not the best for Mother Earth. Yeah. Like black sludge is coming out of this.
It's just like oozing out slowly.
No, it was like.
Oh, God.
Like shooting out. It was all, yeah. But that Honda engine ran and ran and ran. Remember that car? And then.
Yeah.
And then,
despite your muffler problems, your car was louder than a modern F1 car.
It was louder than a modern F1 car. It was amazing. I drove it with earplugs. But the thing is, it was a Honda, and I lit it. And yeah. I did when I
retired that car from my life. I let it sit there for about 2 months with the driver's side window missing, and that rusted all the ignition column and everything so that it wouldn't start anymore and had to be hotwired. Remember, I gave that car to another friend of ours.
Yes.
And he drove it for weeks after. It's still red.
Literally weeks.
That was a Honda engine.
And okay, so remember Spence that we met?
The engine was built in 1993.
We met Spence at the Canadian Grand Prix, right?
Yeah.
Buddy from Windsor. And what I remember that way, way back when it wasn't even announced fully, but when there were talks about Honda coming into F1, I remember him saying, and I immediately agreed, like, yeah, Honda as a company, they can, you know, if you look at their road car performance, they know how to build a V6 turbo. You know what I mean? Like they do. They have very successful cars out there that have V6 turbo engines, or at least just V6s. So
the funny thing is, when you think of a Honda road car, you think of reliability.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I mean. Yeah,
that's the one word that you would describe Honda.
Yeah. Well, it's right now what the Honda Civic was for years and years in a row. I don't know if it still is, but it was Canada's best-selling car. It was.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because of that. Because it withstood the harsh Canadian winters as well as our stupid hot summers and everything else. It was a car with a V6 engine that was known for its reliability. And now, if anything, from the moment that they've come to F1 this year, if they were hoping to get any kind of good publicity out of it, they're not. No. They can't.
No.
They can't. They can't. They can't advertise. So Honda right now is basically just throwing money at F1, like just throwing money at it. Right? Not doing it. Like they're not getting any return on their investment. If anything, they're getting a negative return on their investment. When is that going to change? But they've committed themselves already. For a couple of years, so well, I would think that in a pragmatic Japanese mind, they would say, you know what, we have to figure this out,
right?
Because we're already committed, because we have no other choice.
Publicly, they've committed themselves forever.
But yeah,
but the story will be so much.
Honda will be in F1 forever. That's what they said.
The story will be so much sweeter down the road when they've, you know, clearly fucked up and then brought it back. You know what I mean?
Yeah, because
I could see that as a mentality that they would pursue that sort of avenue.
Yeah. Is that a sustainable business model though?
I don't know. If they're into commitment, it's like they are. I mean, they haven't really left that Japanese island, so I
mean. Yeah.
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 They're committed.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But anyway, going back to the Grand Prix, Lewis Hamilton qualified first. They didn't finish the race first. Guess who won? Rosberg.
Oh man!
How Rosberg's crazy just was like, that?
Yeah, okay.
Well, it was because of the start. Do you guys see that start?
No.
Do you see that start?
Yeah, we were talking about this just before you got here. It's kind of weird. I saw this Tobias Gruner tweet.
Oh, here. I got it right here.
Hold on, guys.
Hold
on to your dicks.
It's a little bit strange that Mercedes would release something like this. Unless Nico Rosberg was the number two driver.
Yeah, but okay. So we've met, like we know Toby now, right?
Yeah.
And we know his connections. The thing is that Tobias Gruner, from Automotor und Sport, however you say it in German. they're based out of Stuttgart, and both him and Michael Schmidt, not you.
Yeah, the other one.
The Michael Schmidt. they work out of Stuttgart, and presumably they have a lot of connections inside the Mercedes on the Mercedes corporate side. Not the Mercedes F1 team, which actually operates out of Britain, but the Mercedes corporate. So they clearly have some sort of an in, because every time that I've heard something come out like on Tobias Twitter relating to Mercedes, something that's like this big, something controversial, it ends up being true in the end.
Mm-hmm.
So I have full confidence that this is what happened.
Well, I think that you could probably see this from the video anyway, but I don't know. It's, I don't think it's a big, that big of a news.
Do you think they might have been? It's kind of.
I think it's weird that Mercedes would, unless this is like some kind of a leak, I guess, that he got an inside line, that Mercedes would let this kind of news out, unless Hamilton was all butthurt about getting a slower start off the beginning of the race.
So what exactly does the second little sentence say, or the third?
Daddy, explain.
Was distracted by high weight revs.
I guess like the 5 second countdown was longer than normal. Because there's no, it's not actually 5 seconds.
Right.
No. I guess.
It's like they make it up.
It sounds just like an excuse that they're, you know, they're just sitting there like, and you wait for the, they wait for the five lights to go out.
Right.
So it's like an arbitrary amount of time.
Yeah, Charlie Whiting decides. Yeah,
he gets to press the 5, 4, 3, 2. And then he presses whenever.
Like, yeah,
the drivers are sitting there like
just waiting to like lift the clutch
until the five lights go out. Just to let off the clutch and go.
Holy fuck.
Well, yeah, it's they're
ridiculous fucking thing.
There's a guy. His name is Charlie Whiting.
Yeah.
He keeps coming up in F1 news because he has a very high position in the.
He's sitting in literally high in that box over the finish line. He's sitting up in that glass box.
He's quite stoned.
He's a race controller. and he works for the FIA, but he's probably the person in and follow me through this thought. He's the highest ranking person in the FIA that has nothing to do with politics, right? Like his job is strictly he's the race controller. He does race control, and he's like all he thinks about it, like he's not influenced by anything else other than the rules of the sport, and he's there as the top shepherd of it happening. And As a bonus, well, not that's a bonus,
a good,
but like
good word, I guess, Shepard.
Yeah, as the guy that does that, he is the guy that he presses the. There's a button. He presses a button, and that button turns off the lights, and that's when the race starts. Now, when that happens, that's entirely up to him. Yeah.
Now, yeah. So I guess that's basically what they mean. I guess it was. I think longer
was
than
it,
normal.
Was it odd? Like, was it something you guys noticed?
Ericsson jumped the start, so I think that with that in light, it may have been like milliseconds longer than some drivers may have expected. But Ericsson making a mistake like that is not the same as or not what you would expect of Hamilton.
Right.
Because Hamilton shouldn't be thinking or like doing the count in his head. He should be looking at the lights in front of him.
Right.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. Who knows what he was. Either driver was thinking or.
What did Hamilton get? Third?
Second
place.
Of course. Oh.
Massa was third.
Oh, right.
And the Mercedes team is so far ahead of everybody else.
Right.
At this point, like, we know.
5 second penalty.
You know what? We have
Hamilton oh, really?
Yeah, during the race. Coming out of the pits, he crossed the white line, the pit exit line.
Oh, shit. And he still got second.
He got distracted. He was with the steering wheel like this. He's looking down or something, and he just drifted over the line and, like, whoop.
I guess he must have been checking, you know, his followers
or Twitter.
Twitter. He's gotta wait till that album drops, right?
Oh yeah,
send that shit. Wait, is it out?
No, it's not out yet.
We gotta premiere that shit.
No, as soon as it comes out, man.
Yeah. Lewis Hamilton, if you're listening, come on by. All right, next time.
Yeah, yeah.
Give us an exclusive.
When on your way to LA, stop by Toronto. But don't worry, we'll promote your album.
We'll do the shit.
Regardless of anything that us three think about you, we will promote.
Oh yeah, bring your dog too.
Yeah, where is Roscoe?
I named my fantasy league names after your dog. So yeah,
Roscoe Rockets.
Roscoe Rockets.
Yeah, that's true.
I'm in third place on one of them.
And Daniel's
actually
here for they can hang out.
Oh, living room. Danny hates everything. Little Daniel.
Yeah,
he's a dog.
Hates his
shadow.
There's
a dog here with the same name as me.
Yeah, and like you. Shit's in the hallway.
Excuse me.
I'm just kidding.
I'll be right back.
He doesn't shit in the hallway.
Can we go to the next
Absolutely.
So this is the venue of the Russian Grand Prix.
What?
The pit straits, basically. Yeah, there's been giant big flooding in that part of Russia right now, and that's what it looks like.
Is there a Russian Grand Prix this year?
Yes, there is.
Oh, really?
There.
So is it like a boat race? Yeah. How is this gonna work?
And now I definitely lifted this picture from Reddit.
Yeah.
Sorry, but somebody posted on the comments that, oh, is there like a boat? And I'm basically saying like, is there like a boat F1? And yes, apparently. And I looked at this. There is and it's called F1H2O.
Get the fuck off! Really?
Yeah. Amazing. Look it up, man. Look it up. Look it up on YouTube right now. Type F1H2O. Yep, there you go. Yeah. They're speed boats. Yeah.
Oh, what the fuck?
Yeah, F1H2O.
This looks weird.
Yeah. There's
these kids looks like fucking manta rays. Yeah. You know, like they fucking jump out of the water.
Yeah. We were talking about the Russian Grand Prix. Yeah. Sochi, how it's flooded. Then they might need to do something.
Yeah, no, that makes a lot of sense.
I actually went ahead and actually watched one of the races. Their races are very short.
Oh,
because,
really?
Because I don't know why.
Just die.
But you get intense accidents when these things go when something happened and when they fly up in the air. No, they go like way up, man, 100 meters in the air, man. It's dude. It's like, and the tracks are very simple because of that, probably. Yeah, man. They're up, man.
Have you guys seen this dolphin? This mechanical dolphin.
Oh, the dolphin is awesome.
I was just
going to
bring that up because I want to see that as like a sport. Like,
yes.
Where it's like there's like parts of it where it's like on top of the water and then like there's
obstacles in the water.
Points you have to go under. It's like.
It's a gasoline powered mechanical dolphin.
It's awesome.
And
you
ride inside like a fighter jet underwater.
And you're like.
It's amazing.
Okay, let's look that up.
Yeah, bring it up.
What is it called?
I don't know. Sea dolphin. I don't know.
Just
dolphin boat.
Yes, there it is.
Oh yeah, I can see that plastered with fucking advertising.
That thing goes underwater, man. Like you can control it in all kinds of ways.
Also, one looks like a shark. That's hilarious.
Amazing.
What is it? It's got okay. I was looking at the tail, right?
No, man, it goes underwater, man. It's so cool. That thing is so amazing.
Right, sponsored by Shell. Right?
Yeah. I can see Ferrari investing some money in
absolute.
There.
Absolute.
Absolute amount.
Let's check this one out. Fuck yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then like you're racing, and then real dolphins show up and beat the shit out of you. A fucking gang of them. Got scars and shit. One's got...
Going back to Sochi, though.
Yeah, let's do it. Yeah, I can totally see that.
No, but this is crazy. Like, what?
Yeah, how is this possible?
Yeah.
This is the Olympic Village in Sochi, Russia is underwater right now.
Actually, all of Sochi, Russia. Even the suburbs. Yeah, man. Like, it's fucked.
I thought this was just in a valley downtown or something.
No. Most of Sochi right now is fucked. F1 is gonna come here come November.
Yeah.
So I'm sure it will be dry by then, but it's funny to see it like this.
Yeah, like I've never seen it not like this. You know what I mean? Like this is the first time I'm really
your first peek.
Like I'm not really sure where the road is. I'm assuming it's underneath the water right here.
Yeah. Well, that's a pit lane, and this is like the actual like race, like the actual here. Circuit.
Oh, it's right. Oh, okay.
So that's now. Circuit. This is a pit lane.
The race fence there.
Oh, yeah. Dope.
It's all things considered, and I know that, Daddy, you may not agree with me 100%, but I think that the Sochi track, all things considered, was okay. I thought it was okay.
It's okay, yeah. It's not great. I don't know. It's I like it except for elevation.
Yeah, this guy is completely.
If you're
plain.
Gonna build hundreds of millions of dollars on a F1 track, put some elevation.
Is this it?
Yeah, yeah.
Holy shit! Yeah.
But it's big. It's big. It's one of the biggest ones.
That one on the left is maybe. Oh, it's kind of a small image, but it's built in and around through the Olympic Village.
Yeah, you know how Russia had the Winter Olympics
in Sochi.
Yeah, yeah. So that's it's so oh, the yeah this was the hockey rink, and then like you know what I mean, like that, like they hosted some of the Olympic events around here, and then after the Olympics were done, then they kept building it, so it was an F1 track.
Man, almost 6 kilometers. That's fucking crazy.
It's big. Yeah,
it's the big. Third longest, I believe. Yeah.
Which is the longest?
Spa.
Obviously. Spa.
Okay. Yeah, spa.
And then Silverstone this coming weekend or next weekend.
Yeah. Fuck yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah, Silverstone's the second longest.
Except it's all flat, and honestly, if an F1 track could have elevation, it should.
Yeah.
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 But yeah, it's pretty cool. Like you see that big U corner there.
Yeah, that looks fucked.
It's pretty cool. It's unique. And it's on a negative camber.
If you don't do anything to stop your car from like if you don't handle your car will just like drive away just out of its own volition because it's negative camber.
Really?
Right. And
as opposed to like something like a NASCAR where it's
being
like
banked in. Yeah. It's right.
And this is the oh.
Oh no! This corner has
only
like
very slightly,
this corner has like 3 or 4 apexes.
Yeah,
that meaning that like you have to like if you're gonna like take the fastest line, you have to hit it there and there.
Oh damn!
Yeah, you have to hit like the inside corner, I guess.
Coming the other way though.
Yeah. Or right? Yes. Yeah, sorry. Yes. Likewise. There, and there. I think it's not bad.
It's definitely interesting.
Yeah,
almost looks like a snail.
It's like more interesting when you consider what we were talking about a couple weeks ago, though, that Russia seems to be trying to negotiate Moscow Grand Prix.
Yeah,
in downtown.
They basically Moscow. Like spend billions of dollars making this happen, and they're just gonna abandon it.
They're like, eh.
Yeah, done. Basically.
Yeah. But I guess Russians are in a position right now where they can do that, especially when things happen like this. Do we have anything else to talk about? Oh, wait, hang on. Let me go back to the weekend that just passed. So the only thing that I said was really that like Red Bull's magic is done, is gone. We talk a lot typically, like people that are into F1 talk a lot about Red Bull when it's the Austrian Grand Prix, because the Austrian Grand Prix really only made it back into the calendar because of Red Bull's boss, Dietrich Mateschitz. I don't know.
Massive shits.
Massive shits. Yeah. So Dietrich Massive Shits was really like the main reason, because he's Austrian and he wanted to see
Red Bull owns it now.
Yeah. So it used to be called
the Red Bull Ring.
Yeah, it used to be called back. Historically, it had been called the A1 Ring. Then it was called the Österreich Ring.
Österreich Ring.
But now, leading up to the Austrian Grand Prix, we had DJ Massive Shits releasing in releasing in one of his publications a statement saying that he's basically immune from leaving an F1, and if he wants to leave F1 any day, he'll do it. And I want to push it the statement that he's been saying that Red Bull has been saying that for a while, but now it's real because it's coming from Massive Shits, and now he's saying it. He's saying that he's not impervious from leaving an F1 or whatever. And like, I guess because they're not winning anymore, like, or because they can't figure out a way how to win, or because they can't even beat their junior team, Red Bull, Toro Rosso. Yeah. Now they're all kinds of hurt. And he's saying that he could leave F1 any second. You know what? To me, they should just take him up on the offer. Leave F1 and if we don't ever see the Austrian Grand Prix and that venue again, that's fine by me, because to me it wasn't...
I prefer Sochi to the Red Bull race.
Yeah. To me, and you know what? We were talking about this with Michael Schmidt in Montreal, and I was vocal about it, and I told him, like, you know what? Like, you can't possibly convince me to go to the middle of Austria.
That's the other problem. It's in the middle of nowhere.
Yeah, to the middle of nowhere in Austria.
I'm down with camping.
I'm down with camping, but you can go camping in a spa. You know what I mean? Like, but yeah, you can't convince me to go to watch a race that
looks like a whale.
Yeah, but it's not. It doesn't only just have 9 corners. It's also a short track. There's not much you can do here.
Yeah, what was it like? 97 laps or something past weekend. It was a lot of laps.
Yeah, it was ridiculous, and I think that. You know, whatever. Okay, so before the Austrian Grand Prix, it was the Canadian Grand Prix.
If we're gonna come back in 2 years, 5 or 6 seconds faster too at this track.
Yeah. But okay, so we had a okay. So the consensus has been mostly that this race in Austria was boring, ish. You know, there was
more or less than Canadian Grand Prix.
I'd say more.
More boring.
Yeah, it was more boring than the Canadian Grand Prix. Yeah. Now, the
at least there was the gopher.
Yeah.
The beaver.
the
beaver.
But at the Canadian Grand Prix, though, like, it's rare that happens.
Right.
The Canadian Grand Prix but the Canadian Grand Prix, if anything, it's known for being one of the most exciting races of the year.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right? It was... I don't want to say it was a fluke, because it was definitely a consequence of what's going on in F1 as
rule sets.
Yeah, in the large scheme of things, like the Canadian Grand Prix wasn't exciting because of other things that were happening, because you know, engine conservation and fuel conservation and all that. But this was boring, and it was boring 2 years in a row. I didn't have fun watching. I was dozing off during this Grand Prix this year and last year, even though Rosberg won last year, and it was another upset, and Massa qualified pretty high, and Massa did again pretty good at this Grand Prix. I still felt like there's something missing. This is just this track has been outgrown by F1. Like, look at it. Just look at it, and you can see.
Yeah, you can see it.
you know
what it needs, actually?
A time machine.
No, it's got to fulfill the whale thing. So what I'm suggesting...
Oh, I see the whale now.
How do you not see a whale there? That's all I see.
Oh, yeah. I see the whale.
See, it's like the tail? Yeah, the tail. And so what needs to happen here is... It goes like this, right?
Oh, yeah.
Right, and that's like the fin or something.
Yeah, okay.
Boom. Problem solved. Red Bull, call me. All right, I will work for you. I will fucking tell you what you need to do.
It looks like they have...
That was for free.
There is an extension to the track. They're just not using it.
Yeah. Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, see, that's so much cooler.
Yeah, they could. They could use a long thing, but I don't know, man.
So, wait, what's the... do you guys know how long...
It's like 3.4.
Go to work. Go to
work. Oh, I already did it.
4.3.
There it is.
Almost. 10 points.
But yeah, anyway.
Shortest lap of the year.
So yeah. So I think that if Red Bull's chief, DJ Massive Shits, is threatening to leave the sport, you know what, Bernie? You know what, Jean Todt? Let him go. Let him go and let him take the Austrian Grand Prix without him, because it would be a sad day, like a sad year, the year that we have an F1 calendar with the Austrian Grand Prix and not Spa or Monza. You know what I mean? Like if they sacrifice, because you know those two are in the line, like in the fucking target line.
Yeah,
you know that Bernie.
I could go without Monza too.
Okay, fine. And I know that you don't prefer Monza, but Monza at least has exciting racing.
Yeah, but F1's kind of outgrown it too.
Okay, right, but like
Not as much as
Spa isn't a bigger danger than Monza. It would be a sad day, the day that we don't have a Belgian Grand Prix at Spa and we have an Austrian Grand Prix. It would be a sad day.
Well, yeah, if that happens. I don't want to see Red Bull go, though. That's four more cars. They're down to 14.
Yeah.
14 cars if they leave? Come on. No. They can't. Come on, Red Bull.
Yeah.
No. They can't leave.
They make so much fucking money from those goddamn sugar cans.
Red Bull juice.
That's, yeah, it's Bull's just
testicle juice.
Yeah, really.
Another thing that happened during practice was, I mean, everybody was going off the roads. But
was it raining during practice?
Yeah, it was kind of wet. Second practice,
sorta.
Yeah, it was just sort of wet. The thing about it is that another thing that people keep saying is like, yeah, okay, so the track hasn't changed much, but now they've added all these tarmac runoff areas that nobody likes. Both McLarens were out within just 15 minutes. And FP2, yeah. Oh, yeah. And I also didn't actually even get to like do much during FP1. As much as they were saying that this weekend was going to be a practice weekend for the McLarens, they didn't do much. So I saw what happened. I tell you, even if that crash hadn't happened during the race between Alonso and Raikkonen, Alonso's car wasn't going to make it the whole race. You could see that.
Probably.
I don't know if it was the elevation, because the one thing is that the Austrian Grand Prix, the Red Bull Ring, as it's known now, it is. Quite high up in the mountains, comparatively to a lot of other ones. Mm-hmm. So maybe the altitude is doing something to those Honda engines. Maybe
the way that their turbo is designed.
Yeah. That crazy way that exactly. Yeah.
Axial turbo or whatever they built.
Yeah.
They just seem to have so many problems. Maybe it's because they tried to turn their engines into people.
Yeah. Yeah. I remember.
Like, I'm sorry. There's something weird about that.
Yeah, there is.
There is something else to be said, though, with this whole Dietrich massive shits. Talking about leaving Red Bull. Because, so he hasn't said...
He's a little butthurt.
Well, yeah, but he's butthurt about something that he shouldn't be. Because his Red Bull team just a year, well, 2 years ago, just got off from, like, winning 4 championships in a row.
Yeah.
Right? And they had been building towards that, and they had been quite successful. And now, just because they're not winning, honestly, just because they're not winning, he's now just, like, vomiting all this shit out of his mouth. And that just makes me think, I mean, this...
Could be a bunch of the Renault stuff, too.
Well, but... I just want to put a comment out there, because... I'm sure, like, and I've read about this shit. This is a condition. Like, once you get to that level of money and that level of power, like, your mind kind of changes, and you start, like, doing all these mental acrobatics. Like, you get what some people describe as a god complex. And this is the same thing that Bernie Ecclestone has.
He paid for a man to jump from space.
Parachuted
down from space.
You know what I mean, though? Like when you're up ago, there, you but
up
you
in space?
You do all these things to justify your line of thinking, and I'm sure I'm not wrong in thinking that Dietrich massive shits right now probably thinks that by him pushing the sport further in the hole than it is by, like, bringing all this bad publicity, I'm sure that he thinks he's actually doing a good thing in his mind. He probably thinks that, oh, I'm just gonna, like, generate all this bad publicity and it'll be great, because if anything, like, F1 will just bounce back and be greater because of this. And even if I sell to Porsche or whatever, or Audi or whatever, it'll be great. It'll be great. It'll be great for the future of F1. Bullshit. Yeah. you're just being a conceited prick.
Well, this is just what I was talking about earlier, and it was that it's just a bunch of drama queens.
Yeah,
it is. It's like people who just talk shit all the fucking time. It's like, this is, I guess, Rosberg got used to that viewing, right? It's a picture of Hamilton's back end. Yeah. Like, Jesus Christ, man.
Jeez. Anyway.
They're going to have to rise above. All right. Yeah. If they want to make this sport great and really nice, like, it seems really petty and kind of like a low. Because I'm sure it's like, oh, you want to generate buzz about something. It's like,
yes.
Start talking shit. Just like, hey, guys.
Yeah, that's the easiest thing, right?
Just go talk
that's
shit.
The easiest thing to do. Talk yeah. shit.
Talk shit. Yeah. And people are like, oh, man. And that's where it's you know, that WWE and wrestling thing kind of are switching sides. Where it's just, I'm not sure how much shit talking is in.
I don't know about the WWE.
It's 110% shit talking. The rest is kind of flexing.
A lot of that is scripted.
Yeah, but it's scripted flexing. So, you know what I mean?
Okay. Anyway, enough talking bad about F1, because regardless of all this, I still think that it's a great sport. And there's still, despite the lack of action on track, I think that there's still a couple of things that we can like take from the Austrian Grand Prix. And it's that...
rename it.
Yeah. Well, no. Seriously. Okay. I honestly believe that tracks like this do need to go. I do have
This one just came back though.
Yeah. Well. Yeah. But I do have a weird emotional attachment for Monza. But maybe if you were like looking at it from a straight looking at the facts and being very pragmatic, you could make an argument for Monza leaving, but at the same time, we need to evaluate it for what it is, and what happened just now at Austria and before that in Canada. It needs to be like a kick in the butt, and for the people that are the decision makers, and somebody that's up there in the F1 strategy commission or whatever you want to call it, the F1 strategy group or the FIA right now, they need to actually examine the situation, and before it gets to the lowest it can be, they should do what's right for the fans, what's right for the sport, and move it in the right direction. Because
you have this page open from ESPN on your laptop right now. Yeah, F1 yeah, does right not now. Need big changes, Jean Todt.
And on that same line, I want. do you have this? Do you have this on the screen, Mike?
Yeah.
I want everybody that's on YouTube that cares the least bit about F1 to look at this face. Look at this face. Remember this face. This is the enemy. This right now, Jean Todt is the worst person that could ever be in charge of F1. No, seriously, I'm not joking. This kind of thinking has no place in the modern world. F1 does not need big changes.
Are you fucked?
Yeah, exactly.
Are you fucked, bud?
If anything, F1 needs the biggest changes that there has been.
Yeah, it's clear. It's clearly.
I agree.
I'm sure, like, maybe you guys are different than me when it comes to this, but I mean, F1 is not nearly as popular as it once was.
Correct.
And that's just sort of how it, like, definitely 20 years ago, 10 years ago, bigger. Yeah. Now it's sort of needs to evolve into its own sort of thing.
Apparently, though, like, well, in the US at least, television numbers are going up. Like almost 30% from last year.
But okay, so I've actually thought long and hard about that phenomenon. And what's happened is that, like many countries around the world, in Canada actually, like more than anything, people are starting to look outwards into the world. Right, like more than ever before, because
there's more opportunity to see other things.
We just live in a very interconnected society, and this is the world right now, right?
Elon Musk.
Yeah, exactly. And as we look outwards into the world and try to find our place in the world, we are exposed to things like F1. So I can see how the rise in popularity of F1 in the States makes sense, because once you actually like get out there and like if you have even a little bit of passion for motorsports, mm-hmm. then you start getting into the history of motorsports, then inevitably at one point or another you will run into F1, and F1 has such a rich history, mm-hmm. and it's just it in the idea that I forgot where I read it, but in some ways it's F1, at least in paper, it's the pinnacle of motorsports.
Right.
When you,
it's yeah, the fastest. It's
arguably, but if anything, it's at least where the most money is being spent, because it's in some ways it is the pinnacle of motorsports. So once you start looking out, if you care at all about motorsports, then you'd agree that the NASCAR is nothing compared to F1.
Oh,
that
yeah.
F1 is just better.
It's the WWE of wrestling.
Yeah, of racing. Yeah. Oh,
yeah, there you go.
So. So at one point or another, then
Mario Kart's like go karts.
then you would agree. Then you start watching F1, and that's what's happening mm-hmm. in the States. That's how at least I can see it, that it makes sense. Mm-hmm. But still, rising audience figures in the States is only gonna go so far. Yeah. It's gonna hit a plateau, and the way that it's going, it's actually not gonna go as far as people might have thought. So at one point, NBC is gonna be like not gonna spend as much cash on F1.
No, it's not
as it might have thought that it would. And if the racing keeps being like this. Mm-hmm. Like the past two Grand Prix, then not even the British broadcasters are going to spend that much money on it.
Right.
And that's where the focus needs to be. As much as they want to invest money or like thought hours into figuring out how to make
thought the, hours. I
yeah.
Like
you know what I mean? Like as much as they want to like invest that into figuring out how to make this sport more grandiose, they need to figure out, first and foremost, how to get the sport out there to the people that are actually interested in right. watching it.
Yeah, I think
Sky is already killing it. All they have to do is not stay behind this pay system that they want. Like,
but they're there. They're there because they're locked out.
We cannot pay for Sky if we wanted to.
Yeah, because we can't. Because by the contract, we should be watching what
maybe
Bernie
Ecclestone. Maybe the TPP will allow us to watch.
No bullshit. No. What we should be watching, according to Bernie Ecclestone, is TSN. And have you you and I have watched a race on TSN, and it's bullshit.
Yeah, it's garbage. Yeah. It's like a waste of time.
Yeah.
I'd rather wait. I'd rather watch the race on Tuesday from Sky.
Yeah.
Sorry.
It's, you know what, like it's a high barrier to entry. We talk about this all the time.
Yeah.
And that I feel like.
Yeah, it's silly.
Aside from you guys, I don't, and like one other of my friends, no one watches F1. It's just not in the culture. It's just not in the scene. And if you want to sort of inject that into a culture or society, you have to, because of the nature of it, like half of it, I remember telling you on the Montreal Grand Prix, I was just like, half the shit is just shit talking.
Yeah.
And like now you understand, like it's really understanding the major players and
the personalities of the sport.
Yeah, exactly. Because that's what makes it interesting and fun to talk about.
For sure.
Like, hockey's not that fun to talk about. Like you're just like, oh, there's another game tomorrow. There's a game after that.
Every team plays at least 90 games.
Yeah, right. It's something silly like
games
that.
Per season,
so there's always
crazy.
there's no time to talk and speculate because there's always shit going on.
Plus,
I mean,
me, the key word with hockey is game. That's the key word. That
the thing is, like, it's a two and a half hour sort of event.
Yeah,
three times a week, four times a week at maybe on the most,
depending what teams you want to cheer for.
Well, I mean,
you can watch like three times a day.
What, Monday? Okay, so like, it'd be like a Monday, Wednesday, Saturday. That's a
hockey?
That's typical hockey sort of fashion. Where like F1 is every 2 weekends,
every second week, every third week,
something like that. And it does. There's like an excitement that builds.
Oh yeah. Are you talking about the fever?
Yeah, that fever.
No, for sure. Yeah. What once you get it, you get it.
What I'm saying is like finding a new way to sort of tackle that and getting people interested in F1, not just like supplying it, but like being able to introduce it to people.
For sure. Yeah. 100%.
Like, I wish more people had friends like you guys to help them and to ask questions, because I see your guys' passion. I'm like, okay, there's clearly something very cool here.
Yeah.
And as soon as I have a question, you're like, oh, no. It's like this. It's like, no, it's like, figure it out. Like, yeah. You got it. So that needs to be, and I'm not sure if that needs to change based on, like, needs to change the sport in order for that to happen, but.
Listen, I'm always the optimist, and I honestly want to think that the future is going to be rosy for F1, but can you just go up this page just a little bit? Yeah, I think that figures like this have to realize that their time is overdue, and figures like maybe even Bernie Ecclestone. There's been articles recently written by Eddie Jordan, who was, he's now an F1 commentator, but he used to be an F1 team owner.
Oh,
yeah,
shit.
He had his own team, Jordan Grand Prix, from he used to race for Ireland. He's an Irish guy, and he's just known for being like this big outspoken
snazzy
guy.
Dresser.
Yeah. Yeah, always with the pink shirts,
sharp attire all the time.
Yeah, but one thing that he said recently is that, yeah, like, you know what, as much as dinosaurs like Jean Todt, this dude, or Bernie Ecclestone have done for the sport at one point or another, they need to realize that the world is changing around them in ways that they don't comprehend, that they cannot possibly ever be asked to comprehend, and they won't ever accept that. So the best thing that they can do for the sport right now is realize that it's their time to step down. Mm-hmm. And that is what I want to say about that. And I honestly don't want to talk about this, because looking at his face just makes me angry.
Think he's ever been on 4chan? Do you think he knows what that is?
Yeah, you know what I mean?
And like the fucking spawn of Satan that breeds there?
They just don't get it, man. Yeah. I mean... And maybe we don't even get it, but at least we know that
we might not get it.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
exactly.
But like, there's too much power, and like, I definitely, people who are,
because
older,
there's a lot of money.
There's a lot of money in there, right?
A lot of money, billions.
It's a mentality of like older generations that are like.
Yeah.
The thing is, like, clearly this guy's old enough to have experienced, like, even if he was rich, his family was rich, but there might have been times where like there was people fucking dying in front of you.
You know what? One day I will, because he actually has a very interesting career. Jean Todt actually started, you know or not. He was a rally co-driver in the he was, that's how he started in motorsport. He was a rally co-driver.
Very good at lists.
But anyway, I will chart his career one of these days that we do the podcast.
Right,
but
4:30 over crest, bank through narrow gate.
This is what rally co-drivers do.
Is it the guy just like sitting? Wait, is he like, in the car?
Yeah, he's in the car sitting like with a list of like when the next guy's gonna turn. Like he's gotta tell him how to turn.
Oh Jesus!
Left 2:20, dip.
Yeah,
rough terrain onto asphalt. 40% over. Yeah. They just read the list of directions.
Either way, he was his place and his time in motorsports was the 80s, the early 90s, the late 70s, not today. And you can apply the same logic with Bernie. Bernie Ecclestone did at one point in history took F1 from basically a sport that was in complete chaos and not really generating enough money to sustain itself to a worldwide phenomenon. And obviously along the road he was definitely helped by the fact that there were world star figures like Senna, like Hakkinen, like he was definitely helped by that. But the fact is that like he helped build the infrastructure,
right?
And it was because he was there, because he was the strong man making the strong decisions, and basically being radical when nobody was being radical. Bernie Ecclestone, and not him, but the guy that preceded him, Max Mosley, because they were there to make tough decisions when nobody would dare make tough decisions back in the 70s and 80s, that they created what is now modern F1. The thing is that now they're just riding on those on that wave,
and it's
the world is
it's a new age.
And there's another radical change that needs to happen in the sport. And as much as we as fans would protest and whatever, like at the end of the day, we are going to keep watching F1. But it's easy to see that the sport does need to change. And again, yes, sorry, I need to stop talking about this guy. Can you please now move on to this, because I want to take a break from F1 and talk about my girl. Talk about my girl.
Oh, Tatiana.
Yes. So last weekend, during the Austrian Grand Prix weekend, what also happened is that the European Formula 3 was happening at Spa. I remember when we talked to Tatiana, she said there's three races, right? So in each one of their weekends, there's three races. And let's say the first race, was kind of uneventful for the two people that we care about, who are Tatiana Calderon from Colombia, widely known as probably the most promising female driver in F1. We interviewed her. If you're just listening to our podcast, go back to our podcast number 19, I think, or 18. 19, I think. No.
What's this one?
I don't even know, dude, to be honest.
20-something.
Yeah, 20 something. Anyway, we interviewed her. We talked to her for an hour. Anyway, she is widely recognized as one of the best female driver out there in the Formula One feeder series. And also we've been talking about Lance Stroll, who is Canadian, and he's in the Ferrari Drivers Academy. So during the first race at Spa, not much happened to both. They did their best, but they finished, like, you know, let's say they didn't write a story. Now the second race was very interesting, and now let's remember when we talked to Tatiana last year in F3, she actually achieved a best finish of her career in fifth. So she finished fifth at Spa last year. It's a track that she actually really likes, and she talked to us about Spa, and she said that she really liked it. Now, the second race was very interesting because Lance was actually leading, and he was poised to actually finish first and win the race.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, he was doing very well. But unfortunately, his inexperience showed. And at one point, I believe it was after the safety car was released, because they had a safety car moment. And then after the safety car came back into the pits, when it came the turn for everybody to push, he was pushing as much as like the number two or three. And he was kind of unaware of his surroundings and turned a hard left, and somebody was there, and he, like, it was so drastic he wiped the other guy out, and the stewards deemed it such a bad accident and like so obviously like Lance's fault that they didn't let him, they banned him from the third race at Spa. So what? Lance,
oh,
yeah.
Oh no.
No, it was bad. I actually watched all three races, and yeah. As much as I really don't want to say this, and honestly, if you're on the fence right now, don't take it from me. Like, I'm not trying to convince you to watch Formula 3 over Formula 1, because it's not the same at all. It's not the same kind of action, obviously. But in those instances, at least, I can tell you I had more fun watching Formula 3 than I did Formula 1.
Right.
But just because it was, you know, we were watching after. Anyway, so Lance turned, did a hard left, took some guy out in such a dangerous way that the stewards deemed him not capable of racing.
Out.
Yeah, you're disqualified for the third race. But the third race now. So in the format of Formula 3 is that they do two races on a Saturday and one race on the Sunday. on the Sunday race, it had rained.
Oh, fuck. Rain?
Yeah, so it rained. It rained, and it was... Spa is such a big track, and this is common. Like, this has happened, like, in F1. Like, so it can be damp and wet on one end and bone dry at the other.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, it's
rad.
Yeah, it's crazy. And the end, it has elevation, and it's got whatever. Anyway, Spa is sick. And Carlin team with Tatiana, because Tatiana is still, like, we talked about this with her. She still has to work on her qualifying pace. Mm-hmm. And as much as she wants to say, with a valid argument, obviously, that there is just a lot of bad racing in Formula 3 now, because a lot of 16, 15-year-olds. So many youngsters have come in after Max Verstappen got lifted from this series right into F1.
Jesus.
So whatever. So she's still not awesome at qualifying. So she qualified somewhere in the 20s, like, let's say 27th, for the third race. And Carlin, her team, saw, you know what? The track is still a little damp. So the top of the first few guys, they all were running on slicks, on dry tires. And they gave her wet tires. And down from 27th, or wherever she was, like deep down in the 20s, man, within the first few, I remember watching, and like, you can watch it on YouTube right now, like European Formula 3, they have a channel, the third race at Spa. Please, like, if you have any interest in this, please watch it. The first few laps, the commentators aren't even commentating on her, because they're focusing on, like, the battle that's happening in, like, first, second, and third. But you can see car number 9 is her. Mm-hmm. And there she is, like, in the picture that we're showing right now. On
the only one on wet tires.
Yeah, the only one on wet tires. So she goes from 27th or wherever, and within the first, like, 2 or 3 laps, she passes, like, 5 or 6 people, man. It was crazy. Like in the first corner, like, she's like just like passing, like, 2 or 3. The next corner, another 2 or 3. Like, she's going and she's going, and like you can see, like, she and this is what I watched an interview with Rob Wilson, which is like a legendary F1 trainer, and he said that this is a serious racer, and you can see her racecraft.
Yeah,
her actual, like, she can actually race. She may not be able to qualify. Yes, she may not have qualifying down
right
pat yet, but she knew
she had that, like, hunger.
Well, but no, she more than that, she knew the strengths and weaknesses of her car. She knew that she was on wets, so she knew that she had to take different lines,
right?
And you could see it clearly, especially around Spa. You could see her, like, just diving, like, the other guys were going to the left and she would go to the right part of the track, because she was like just chasing those wet spots because she knew she was on the wets. And, like, with that, she actually made it to first. And she led the Belgian F1 or F3 Grand Prix for a number of laps ahead of all of the championship leaders.
Yeah,
ahead of them, and, like, there's great racing, like, passing each other, and then you'd see the guys, like, when in the parts of the track where it was bone dry, she'd definitely, like, lose position, and then the guys would just, like, just take, like overtake her, just in a normal overtake, and then she'd go, like, when it was wet, like, she would know, like, okay, so not necessarily this side of the corner, but that side is gonna be wet, so I'm gonna, like, pass the guy on the outside. Dude, man, she passed so many guys on the outside. It was incredible. It was so much fun to watch. That was amazing. I thought that was a great job, and she got great publicity, and if anything, this is gonna, like, you just have to watch it. Like, I'm sure that even you, as somebody that just started getting into a single seater racing, you would be able to appreciate how the other guys are doing one thing and she's doing another thing, just looking for those wet spots. And obviously, they were obviously gambling. Carlin, her team, was obviously gambling and hoping for maybe a drizzle towards the end of the race. If there had been just as much of as a drizzle, she would have won.
Oh yeah,
no, guaranteed. No, guaranteed. Yeah, guaranteed. She would have won because she was just she got first. Like at one point, like even the commentators that were trying to commentate on the first like three positions, they were like, "Whoa!" Like Tatiana Calderon is here, but I had been watching her from the beginning. I knew like, yeah, she's advancing through the fields like crazy.
Yeah.
And even when towards the end, it was very clear that she had to go and switch to slick tires. Mm-hmm. So she did go into the pits and lost her lead and like was dropped like pretty much at the same position that she started.
Oh,
she's still with like five or six laps to go, still had enough time to advance up till like 21st position. So she's like, and
oh, crazy.
She's good at Spa, and being good at Spa tells you something. Mm. I am more confident than ever before that if there's a female driver out there that's gonna end up in F1, it's gonna be her.
Mm. Absolutely.
Yeah.
It's almost 5:30, by the way.
Oh shit. Well, whatever. We still got. Danny, what do you got? Well, actually, I want to bring light to. I want to bring light to this. The guys have five lights.
Oh yeah, we were just talking.
Yeah, so Silverstone, the British Grand Prix is coming up. Another all-time great Grand Prix. Actually, it was the very first Formula One Grand Prix ever. Like under the umbrella of Formula One. There had been Grand Prix before, but in the Formula One World Championship started there in Silverstone. And actually it has this stat that I find kind of interesting is the first live sporting event ever attended by a reigning monarch. Queen Elizabeth went to the first.
Well, that's crazy. Yeah.
Grand Prix, Queen Elizabeth II.
That is
yeah, but it's a great track. It's a great Grand Prix. And the guys from the Five Lights podcast, check them out at fivelightspodcast.com. They put on, if you're British or if you're going to the British Grand Prix, check it out. They've been going to the Grand Prix for years, and they basically like give you some top tips of what to avoid, what to do once you're there. Danny, talk us through the British Grand Prix.
Can we look at an onboard lap? I was saying before, it's the second longest lap of the year.
Oh, you know what? As long as it's on YouTube, we can look at it. Hang on a second. I'm just going to excuse myself for a second.
Yeah, find us a video on YouTube of a lap. Oh,
what the hell did I do?
Yeah, it's a former Royal Air Force base.
What, Spa, right?
No, no, Silverstone.
Oh, right.
Yeah. Should be one word. Onboard, yeah. There we go. 2013. Let's get some volume. There we go. There's a final corner. So they just built this new pit straight here 3 years ago, I think. That first corner's taken flat out almost 300 kilometers an hour.
Jesus Christ.
The first corner.
Oh.
They got 300 here, 310, 315, and
this is fucking crazy.
Yeah, it's a fast track. So here's the old pit lane.
Oh, okay.
This is the old first corner coming up to here. It's also just about flat out. Slight lift there.
Oh shit.
And here's the big S back and forth.
Oh my god.
So fast. And then the back straight. Again, up over 300. No big deal, you know, 315.
Holy
200
shit.
For this corner. the final chicane here. Back onto the new front straight. And that's a lap. See how fast it was, too, though?
That was nutty. That was way too fast. The second longest lap. I was feeling very uncomfortable.
And it's, it's like that.
Hold on. I'll be right back.
Yeah, it's craziness.
British Grand Prix. I like the British Grand Prix every year.
I love Silverstone.
Yeah. It'd be cool to go, except like the tickets are ridiculous, man.
Yeah, I don't know why they're so. I know why they're so expensive, because they can be.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, British people will pay for that.
Yeah,
but some of them. Well, that's another one that the main thing is camping. You go there to camp.
Exactly.
It's like most of the tickets, you pay for the ticket and your campsite.
Yeah.
It would be cool, man. One day.
So if I had to choose between this and Spa, I don't even know.
No, I choose Spa.
I don't even know what I choose.
I choose Spa.
I don't know. I guess.
Only because, no, so. Let me tell you why. Well, actually, yeah, I think so. Apparently, according to the Five Lights guys, with general admission, you can go all around the track here.
Oh, yeah, all the way around.
Which would be cool. But at Spa, the general admission spots, even though they're not all around the track, they're at the key positions. Like you can see Eau Rouge pretty good. You can see the Camel Straight pretty good. So it would be a tough decision.
Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, this is only like an hour and a bit away from London, so you can still plan a better trip if you were to come from North America to see the British Grand Prix. Like it would probably be like. You could make more of a vacation out of it, I guess.
Yeah.
I guess so. It's still.
And everybody speaks English.
Yeah, true. Yeah. Although I still would like to do one day I will get to do Spa Monza. You know what I mean? Like do
back to back.
Yeah, Spa Monza. Well, as long as they're back to back, right? Like they have been over the past few years. Should be a good Grand Prix, though. I mean, but we said that about the Canadian Grand Prix this year, though.
Yeah, it's probably gonna be like this, a bit overcast, as it usually is.
Oh yeah, well, I mean, it's England. It is
England.
I mean, this Ferrari almost looks pink in this video.
Yeah. It could rain, and in fact it did rain hard a few years ago in such a way that most people, most people go to the British Grand Prix to camp.
Yeah.
Uh-oh. And the campgrounds were all flooded, and it was a big mud fest. It was disgusting. Like,
oh, no.
People couldn't get out or in, like, and the traffic jam was so bad that it took 10 hours to get out of the track. That one year when it was really bad.
God.
Yeah. I mean, so being there when it's bad, like when there's bad weather, I'm sure is not the joyous of situations. Mm-hmm. But nonetheless, as somebody watching from across the pond, is still a very good Grand Prix.
As a Brit, I'm sure they're used to it.
Yeah. Anyway. Oh yeah. If you're in England, you're used to the rain, bad food, worse weather. You know, that's
what? Fish and chips. Yeah. That's great.
Any parting thoughts, gents? Danny, what do you got?
I don't know. I'll apologize again for not being prepared this week. I will have, for anyone who missed it, you'll hear my voice more next week. I'll have more to say.
What I want to do, and actually, like, if you're listening to us, and I know that some of you are, because we've been getting emails and Reddit comments and YouTube comments, and whatnot.
Thanks for all the feedback.
Yeah. Thanks. Yeah. Honestly, thanks for all the feedback. We're trying. I want to remind you all that we're still just doing this for the fun of it, and because we love getting together and talking about F1 and well, I mean, at least Danny and I did. Now you're getting
now
into
me.
It. Yeah.
No,
we're very happy that you are. Honestly,
I see the passion in your guys' eyes, and it lights me up.
It's been an amazing ride, and honestly, for anybody, I'm gonna just throw this out there for next time. I won't make it like an official announcement yet, but please let us know if you're in the Toronto area and you'd like me to organize a Grand Prix watching party for the next Grand Prix.
Oh, I will do it. That's a great idea.
I will do it. I have I just moved to this new place a few months ago, and it has an amazing rooftop. We can catch the race there. There's barbecues up there. If we can even do it like a whole like mid morning afternoon event. So yeah, if you guys just let us know.
Yeah.
Let me know flatofever@gmail.com or at flatofever on Twitter, flatofever on Reddit, whatever, or even if you're like seeing us on YouTube right now,
reply
to this comment right now. If you'd like us to organize a Grand Prix watching party, we will do it. I will do it. We have the facilities to do it. So yeah, we can do that, and that's something that I
want. Super sweet.
That's something that I want to say. Danny, if you don't have anything to say, I think the DJ should play us out.
Oh, that was almost too good.
Yeah.
All right, guys, we'll see you later.
Thank you. Bye.